I had a chance to talk with Ethan Hutt, an assistant professor of educational history at University of Maryland College Park. His research focuses on the numbers and metrics that are used to describe, define, and regulate schools in the United States. We talked about structures that underlie how schools operate, including how schools organize time. One of the common systems American schools use to do this is called the Carnegie Unit, a time-based measure for determining student achievement and advancement. Since competency-based education works to shift the focus from time spent on material to mastery of material, it's useful to get an understanding of how time-based systems work. In our conversation, Ethan provides some historical perspective on the Carnegie Unit and talks about both the benefits and the challenges of this system.
So, to understand the history of the Carnegie Unit, you have to think about sort of two uses for the Carnegie Unit that will help think about the history. The first is an internal use. So in the late 19th century, you had increasing numbers of students going to high school and to college. And with that increasing number of students, you had increasing interest in diversifying the curriculum. So you had students who wanted to move away from, say, Greek or Latin and introduce some other things like
science
and English and math. And so when you diversify the curriculum, you need to have some way of equating, if not everyone is taking the same set of courses, what's the relationship between courses in the curriculum? And so you have this internal conversation where people begin to say, okay, we need to assign a value to each course, and a certain number of courses means that you graduate.
Yep.
But then there's the external use. So as you get people increasingly moving from high school into college, you need people to say, okay, well, how many courses do you need to take for a high school diploma, and how many courses do you need to get into college? And so one of the things that the Carnegie Foundation did in the very beginning of the 20th century was to say there are 14 units that you need to complete in high school in order to be eligible for college. And so that was the external use of the Carnegie Unit, and it was that sort of tying together of the system that really made the Carnegie Unit so central to American education. It became the foundational unit by which students measure their progress in schools, and which colleges and high schools considered the eligibility of their students.
What are the advantages for individual educators within this framework organized around the Carnegie Unit?
So, I mean, one way to think about the Carnegie Unit is as a currency, and currencies are based on trust. And so one of the things that I think people sometimes forget about the way that the Carnegie Unit functions is it's basically saying, we trust educators, we trust teachers that if you say this is Algebra 1 and you're going to award a grade for that, and you're going to say this student passed that, that another school, another teacher is going to honor that discretion.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, often educators will talk about, you know, when they sit back and they think, what is the grade the student deserves? They're taking in the whole experience of that child in the class. There's a sort of virtue in a little bit of ambiguity, right?
Mm-hmm.
So allowing people to say, well, this is algebra, but algebra may not be exactly the same in California as it is in Texas or in your class versus my class, but having sort of some broad agreement that we count in a sort of a set unit allows for some variation that you lose if you create a too tightly coupled system.
Mm-hmm.
And so any replacement is going to have to serve a similar function, and it's going to have a similarly clear meaning to everybody who encounters it. There are some subjects where I think you might say that time is more important, the amount of time spent is more important than in some other ones. So if you think about language learning or music or physical education, you know, there might be a good argument to say the time, actually, the number of hours you spend, the number of days in a week that you are doing it, is actually one of the more important parts of the learning experience.
Mm-hmm.
So just doing it every day actually matters in a way that, you know, maybe for some other subjects that are more technical, you know, the competency is easier to ascertain, and you say, well, you don't need to practice it. There's not a value in doing that. So I think there are some parts of the curriculum that are probably more amenable to being measured in time than others.
When do people start critiquing this system, and what are their concerns with it?
They begin critiquing it almost immediately.
Mm-hmm.
So the major critique is just the concern that time is going to displace learning. That when you make the unit of analysis, the amount of time spent in a course, or the amount of time spent on a certain area of the curriculum, that ends up taking precedent. And so what you get is, rather than saying, we're going to study this subject rigorously, and you're going to pass on when you're ready, that no, when the end of the semester, the end of the year comes, we award you the credit and you move on. And there's this basic critique that there really are things that we want students to learn, whether it's citizenship, whether it's a certain amount of geography, whether it's a certain amount of mathematics. People are uncomfortable about this basic equivalence between time and knowledge. And almost immediately, you see people beginning to object about this idea that counting time should matter. That feels very factory oriented. Mm-hmm. The sort of you go and you work and then you leave at the end of the day.
Punch out.
And, exactly. And so people are worried that, you know, maybe time is for the factory and not for the school. Mm-hmm. When we say that all the courses are the same or count the same towards a degree, you know, there are equity concerns that if we know that there are schools that are of unequal quality, mm-hmm. then stripping away the sort of formal equity that we say, regardless of what high school you graduate from in this state, a certain number of units earns you the right to go to college.
Well, as you think about new competency-based learning systems, environments, like what are some of the concerns that you might have having thought about these systems for a while?
Yeah, the concern I have is usually when you displace the time dimension of the Carnegie unit, there's something else that has to sort of take the place as the anchor of that idea. And for a lot of competency-based systems, at least historically, usually testing becomes the big feature of those systems. So we want to displace the time, we're distrustful of what's happening in that course, and we want to make sure that the outcome is what we want, that competency. And usually we assess that competency through testing. And so oftentimes what you get is sort of an overly prescriptive, really narrow sense of what competency is. And so you've gone from one set of constraints around time to another set of constraints around assessment or sort of narrow prescription. And so oftentimes we think that competency-based education will provide educators with more discretion, more opportunities to recognize competencies, but it's really contingent on the kinds of ways that you're going to assess those competencies, how you're going to document them. And so there can be some concerns around how that's done and whether that ends up undercutting the chief argument for why you wanted to do competency-based education.
That's great. Enormously helpful advice. Thanks, Ethan.